Okay, I think we're okay. The Committee on Science, Space, and Technology will come to order. Without objection, the Chair is authorized to declare recesses of the Committee at any time. Pursuant to Committee Rule 2E and House Rule 11-2H4, the Chair announces that he may postpone roll call votes. Today we meet to consider five bipartisan bills. H.R. 1119, the Research and Development Efficiency Act; H.R. 1156, the International Science and Technology Cooperation Act of 2015; H.R. 1162, the Science Prize Competitions Act; H.R. 1158, the Department of Energy Laboratory Modernization and Technology Transfer Act of 2015; and H.R. 874, the American Supercomputing Leadership Act. I'll recognize myself for an opening statement and then the ranking member. The first bill is H.R. 1119, the Research and Development Efficiency Act. This bill requires the Director of the Office of Science and Technology Policy to establish a working group to review and make recommendations on how to streamline and minimize the regulatory burden on scientists, research institutions, and universities. I thank the Chair of the Research and Technology Committee, Ms. Comstock, and the bipartisan co-sponsors, Ranking Member Johnson, Research and Technology Subcommittee Ranking Member Lipinski, for their work on this bill. For several years, the research community has expressed concern that time spent on administrative and reporting requirements for federal research seriously cuts in the lab time and therefore negatively affects the science conducted under those grants. This bill is a step towards addressing these concerns. It directs the administration to take steps to cut through administrative red tape to ensure our nation's research investments are efficient and effective. H.R. 1119 is good research regulatory reform. The next bill is H.R. 1156, the International Science and Technology Cooperation Act, which directs the Office of Science and Technology Policy to establish an entity to identify and coordinate international science and technology efforts to strengthen the U.S. research enterprise. And I thank the ranking member of the Research and Technology Committee, Mr. Lipinski, for introducing this bill. And I also thank the subcommittee's vice chair, Mr. Molinar, the ranking member of the full committee, Ms. Johnson, as well as our colleagues, Mr. Holgren, Ms. Esty, and Mr. Swalwell, for being bipartisan co-sponsors. Coordinated international collaboration on scientific issues, which H.R. 1156 ensures, will improve economic and national security and support U.S. foreign policy goals. H.R. 1162, the Science Prize Competitions Act, is our third bill from the Research and Technology Subcommittee for consideration today. As with the previous two bills, this bill was included as a provision in last year's Frontiers in Innovation, Research, Science, and Technology, or FIRST Act. And I thank the ranking member of the Oversight Subcommittee, Mr. Beyer, for introducing this legislation. Bipartisan co-sponsors include the Vice Chair of the Oversight Subcommittee, Bill Johnson, as well as full committee ranking member Eddie Bernice Johnson. This bill amends the prize competition section of the Stevenson-Widler Technology Innovation Act of 1980. It increases transparency by requiring that the notification of prize competitions must be on a publicly accessible government website. It also clarifies that the head of an agency may enter into an agreement with the private sector for-profit or nonprofit entity to administer the prize competition. Prize competitions have an established record of spurring innovation. H.R. 1162 promotes increased utilization of these competitions within the federal government. Our fourth bill is H.R. 1158, the Department of Energy Laboratory Modernization and Technology Transfer Act of 2015. Mr. Holtgren is taking the lead on this issue, and co-sponsors include Mr. Perlmutter, Ranking Member Johnson, and a number of other Science Committee members, including the Energy Subcommittee Chairman Weber, Subcommittee Vice Chairman Newhouse, and Representatives Warbacher, Neugebauer, Swalwell, and Lipinski. This bill is the product of bipartisan negotiations and demonstrates that we can work together when it comes to updating the operations of the Department of Energy National Laboratory Complex. It also shows this committee stands together in wanting to further open up the capabilities and talents of the DOE to private sector innovators. I look forward to a continuation of this effort in the Senate as a result of the good work that Senator Rubio and Senator Coons have put into a very similar version of this bill in the last Congress. Our final bill is H.R. 874, the American Supercomputing Leadership Act. Again, I thank Mr. Holtgren for his work on this bill along with Mr. Swalwell. This legislation calls on DOE to develop a pathway towards the next generation of supercomputing systems, also known as exascale systems. This area of research was also the subject of the Energy Subcommittee's first hearing this year and one of the most promising areas of research within DOE's portfolio. These are all good bipartisan bills, and I urge my colleagues to support them. We're actually going to skip. I was going to say before.
She's here. Comstock is here.
Oh, she is. Okay. Well, what I was going to say is no longer relevant because I was going to say we were going to first skip the first bill, but the gentlewoman from Virginia has arrived, so we will take the bills in order. And now the ranking member, Ms. Johnson, the gentlewoman from Texas, is recognized for her opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The five bills we are marking up today are bipartisan bills that were introduced in the last Congress, and I plan to support them. Now, that said, I would once again like to call your attention to the fact that we are once again skipping regular order. It would have been appropriate for these bills to go through normal subcommittee markup in advance of the full committee markup so that our subcommittees would have had a chance to exercise the expertise and jurisdiction on these matters. There is no urgency to any of these bills that requires bypassing regular order. In addition, I'm concerned that we are spending our time marking up a number of individual small bills that at one time would have been parts of the comprehensive R&D bill, such as the American Competes Act. When Mr. Norman Augustine appeared before our committee at the end of January, he stated in no uncertain terms, and I quote, "I think America Competes is the most important thing this committee could take on." I agree with Mr. Augustine, and rather than continuing to focus on small bills like these before us today, meritorious they may be, I would hope that we can now turn our focus on working together to hold comprehensive hearings and bipartisan dialogue aimed at reauthorizing America Competes. There are clear policy differences that we will have to resolve. But I can think of no other important way to spend our time than to work together on a piece of substantive legislation like Competes. Turning to the bills before us today, I want to thank Mr. Lipinski and Mr. Molinar for introducing H.R. 1156, the International Science and Technology Corporation Act. International collaborations have led to some of the latest discoveries and developments in science and technology, and many of which have relevance in our everyday lives. By ensuring better coordination among our scientific agencies when involved in international collaborations, we will help create the conditions for future achievements. Next, I want to thank Mr. Beyer and Mr. Johnson for introducing 1162, the Science Prize Competitions Act. This bill makes it easier for agencies to use the prize competition authority granted to them in the 2010 Competes Act. Though prize competitions are no substitute for the sustained investment and long-term approach that traditional federal R&D funding provides, prize competitions can play a useful role in advancing the federal R&D enterprise. I'm also pleased to join Ms. Comstock and co-sponsoring the Research and Development Efficiency Act, H.R. 1119. Just the other day, I met with prominent leaders from the university community, and they shared with me that one of their top priorities is reducing the regulatory burden of federally funded research. When researchers are spending more than 40% of their time on administrative burdens, we know we are not making the most efficient use of our precious federal research dollars. This bill won't solve the whole problem, but it is an important step in the right direction. I'm also appreciative of the efforts of Mr. Swalwell and Mr. Hutchkin in H.R. 874, the American Supercomputing Leadership Act. This legislation authorizes the Secretary of Energy to support research that will increase our nation's computing capabilities by two orders of magnitude. Such advances will allow our scientists and engineers to gain insights into diverse fields of study ranging from surety of our nuclear stockpile to climate change research. And finally, I'm pleased to support the passage of H.R. 1158, the Department of Energy Laboratory Modernization and Technology Transfer Act of 2015, co-sponsored by Mr. Hulcher and Mr. Perlmutter. This bill has a number of different provisions to help spur the commercialization of new technologies developed by DOE laboratories and programs in partnership with the private sector, giving the department and the laboratories more flexibility, as provided in this legislation, will increase the speed with which commercial innovations can reach the American public. In closing, I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the support of these bipartisan bills, and I look forward to a productive markup. For that, I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Pursuant to notice, I now call up H.R. 1119, the Research and Development Efficiency Act, and the clerk will report the bill.
H.R. 1119, to improve the efficiency of federal research and development and for other purposes.
Without objection, the bill will be considered as read and open for amendment at any point. And at this point, we'll recognize the gentlewoman from Virginia, Ms. Comstock, the author of the bill, for her opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Smith. I was pleased to introduce H.R. 1119, the Research and Development Efficiency Act, with Ranking Member Johnson, with you, Chairman Smith, and the Ranking Member of the Subcommittee on Research and Technology, Mr. Lipinski. H.R. 1119 would reduce the regulatory burden on researchers and research universities, as you all have mentioned here. The National Academies is conducting a study of federal regulations and reporting requirements, paying particular attention to those directed at research universities. But other studies have examined the red tape and administrative burden that have been faced by researchers and universities. A 2012 National Academies report includes a key recommendation to, quote, reduce or eliminate regulations that increase administrative costs, impede research productivity, and deflect creative energy without substantially improving the research environment. Last year, the National Science Board referenced results of two federal demonstration partnership surveys on faculty workload, one in 2005 and one in 2012. That on average, researchers spend 42% of their time on meeting administrative requirements. Not only is this a drain on researchers' time and resources, but answering federal regulatory and reporting requirements leaves less time for researchers to spend on actual scientific work. H.R. 1119 would ensure that more of our federal research dollars are spent on research and not on these burdensome regulatory requirements. The bill requires the Director of the Office of Science and Technology Policy to establish a working group under the National Science and Technology Council to review federal regulations that affect research and research universities. The working group is tasked with making recommendations on how to harmonize, streamline, and eliminate duplicative federal regulations and reporting requirements, and make recommendations on how to minimize the regulatory burden on research institutions. I encourage my colleagues to support this bill, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Ms. Comstock. And the gentlewoman from Texas, Ms. Johnson, the ranking member, is recognized for her opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased to join Ms. Comstock in co-sponsoring H.R. 1119, the National Science Board, the Association of American Universities, and the Federal Demonstration Partnership and the National Academy of Sciences have all issued reports just in the last few years expressing concern about administrative burdens faced by U.S. researchers. I was in a meeting last week with representatives of our nation's top research universities, and they expressed to me personally that this is one of their highest priorities. The statistic that we've heard many times is that federally funded researchers spend an average of 42% of their time on administrative tasks. That is time and money spent not doing science. This is a terribly inefficient use of some of our nation's greatest scientific brain power, in addition to being an inefficient use of federal funds. While I believe we must continue to increase our investments in science and technology to remain competitive, we must also ask how we can do more and better with what we have. We all agree that administrative requirements serve an important purpose. They ensure transparency, protection of human and animal subjects, and the wise use of federal resources. That said, we need to find a much better balance than we currently have. The Office of Management and Budget took some small steps in the right direction in their recent rewrite of the federal regulations governing research grants. Agencies have also taken steps to harmonize the grant proposals process and are exploring additional ways to reduce the paperwork burden associated with grant proposals. However, there's still a long ways to go. National Academies just launched a new project to gather better data on the challenges and make very specific recommendations on how to proceed. Ultimately, however, it is the responsibility of federal agencies to make the changes internally and to work with each other and OMB to harmonize regulations across the government. H.R. 1119 would establish an interagency working group under the National Science and Technology Council to make recommendations on how to harmonize, streamline, and eliminate duplicative federal regulations and reporting requirements in order to minimize the regulatory burden on federally funded researchers. The working group would be required to take into consideration the many expert reports and I mentioned earlier. They would also be required to report to Congress periodically so that we can follow their progress. I understand that there are many bureaucratic hurdles to overcome, and this will take some time. In some cases, there may be different views of the costs and benefits of different regulations, and those debates will continue. However, we cannot afford to delay action any longer. The vitality of our nation's research universities and our overall competitiveness will suffer if we do not reduce the administrative workload on our nation's scientific talent. H.R. 1119 is an important step in the right direction, and I want to thank Ms. Comstock for introducing this legislation, and I urge my colleagues to support it. Thank you. Yes. You'll bet.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. We have one amendment to this bill, and the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Lipinski, is recognized to offer it.
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at the desk.
And the clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 1119 offered by Mr. Lipinski of Illinois. Page 3, line 13.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman from Illinois is recognized to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As a former academic, I have a good sense of some of the, unfortunately, overburdensome regulations that have to be followed. Many of them are very important, but there are some that can certainly be can be streamlined. Back in 2012, I worked with the then chairman of the research subcommittee, Mo Brooks, on this issue. We held a hearing and we did some work on this. And I'm just very happy today that we have this bill that Chairwoman Comstock has introduced, a good bipartisan bill on this issue. I have one amendment that would make a small but I think significant change, or important change, I should say, to this bill. My amendment would add an additional criterion for OSTP to consider when looking at university regulations, namely focusing on performance-based goals to ensure taxpayer dollars for research are being spent as they were intended. We all agree that we need to make sure the taxpayer dollars are being spent appropriately. Many of the regulations placed on universities are intended to prevent fraud and waste that result from a lack of oversight. The Office of Management and Budget, the Inspectors General of our research universities, and this committee all have a vital role to play in that oversight, and each has helped to develop the current state of regulations. However, in some cases, regulations in place and reporting requirements they entail create waste. According to the Federal Demonstration Partnership's Faculty Burden Survey, 42% of faculty time related to research grants is spent on administrative duties, as ranking member Johnson just mentioned. This forces universities to hire administrative staff who assist with this paperwork, which drives up the cost of research. In a time when university research funds are already spread thin, we need to make sure that we are not needlessly saddling universities with costly burdens that make researchers focus on paperwork rather than lab work. As an example, researchers with multiple grants are required to report on how much of their time and effort is spent on each grant. But the same Federal Demonstration Partnership, which is an association of federal agencies, universities, and research organizations, found in 2011 that effort reporting is difficult to measure, expensive, and provides limited internal control value. As a result, organizations like the Association of American Universities and the Association of Public and Land-Grant Universities have suggested that existing university records on payroll could be used as part of a process to develop an effective substitute for time and effort reporting. My amendment would ensure that such performance-based approaches are considered by the NSTC working group that examines university regulations. In May of 2013, I wrote a letter to OMB asking that they look into this and other changes to university regulations. While some changes were made at that time, more work remains to be done. And while legitimate disagreement exists over the value of current regulatory regime on universities, I think we can all agree that we should look for new ways to efficiently get the information we need for effective oversight. This amendment, which has the endorsement of the AAU, would be a step in that direction, and I urge my colleagues to support it. With that, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Lipinski, and I'll recognize myself in support of the amendment. This is a perfecting amendment to further require that federal regulations on R&D be reformed based upon performance goals rather than bureaucratic processes. This amendment is in keeping with the spirit of the legislation to minimize the regulatory burden on United States institutions of higher education so that researchers can spend more time on scientific work. I thank the gentleman for offering the amendment. Is there any further discussion on the amendment? If not, the question is on the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, and the amendment is agreed to. If there are no further amendments and a reporting quorum is present, I move that the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology report H.R. 1119 to the House as amended with the recommendation that the bill do pass. The question is on favorably reporting H.R. 1119 to the House as amended. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The ayes have it, and the bill is already reported favorably. With that objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table. H.R. 1119 is already reported to the House. I ask unanimous consent that staff be authorized to make any necessary technical and conforming changes without objection so ordered. The gentlewoman from Texas, the ranking member, is recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Before we go to the next bill, I want to introduce and welcome our newest member, Dr. Foster from Illinois, who is joining the committee, PhD in physics. I recruit scientists. Thank you very much for joining us, and welcome.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson, and welcome to the committee, to the gentleman from Illinois. Pursuant to notice, I now call up H.R. 1156, the International Science and Technology Cooperation Act of 2015, and the clerk will report the bill.
H.R. 1156, to authorize the establishment of a body under the National Science and Technology Council to identify and coordinate international science and technology cooperation opportunities.
Without objection, the bill will be considered as read and open for amendment at any point. And the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Lipinski, the author of the bill, is recognized for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank you for bringing all these bills before the committee for markup today. They're all important bills, and I'm very happy that we've been able to work in a bipartisan manner on these bills, ones that have been in the works for at least the previous Congress. Some have gone back further than that, and things that I think are going to make a difference. This bill is about international cooperation on scientific research. But not just cooperation, most importantly, congressional oversight. Scientific research has always been an international endeavor. From the International Space Station to the Human Genome Project to the discovery of the Higgs boson at the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland, international science collaborations have played a vital role in advancing human knowledge, and the U.S. has long been a leader in this area. Our collaborations with other countries on scientific matters have also added benefits beyond the results of the research. Our national security and economic interests are furthered by scientific collaborations, and we are able to solve many grand challenges facing the world. For example, the State Department, in the years after the dissolution of the Soviet Union, helped provide for assistance for out-of-work nuclear scientists in the former Soviet bloc to partner with American scientists on research projects rather than sell their knowledge to rogue states. Partnerships like this can also introduce people in other countries to the free flow of information that is essential to scientific research, is a central tenet of American democracy. H.R. 1156, International Science and Technology Cooperation Act of 2015, we require the National Science and Technology Council to coordinate opportunities for international science collaboration with the State Department and other federal science agencies. Many federal agencies already work with international counterparts on scientific and technological issues. But until recently, there was no coordinating body to identify new partnerships and to fully leverage existing collaborations. While the administration is taking steps to formulate the strategy for international science cooperation, this bill will ensure that the process moves forward with the appropriate congressional oversight. This bill has passed with overwhelming bipartisan majorities in the past, including a 346-41 vote in 113th Congress. At that time, the CBO said that the bill would not have any significant cost. Scientific issues know no geographic boundaries and deal with problems and opportunities of the highest importance to society. Improvements in such areas as energy security, infectious diseases, space exploration, telecommunications and the internet, and many more are due in part to international cooperation to the benefit of all nations involved. By collaborating with international partners on scientific issues, we strengthen the U.S. scientific enterprise, which helps us to get the biggest return on our investment in scientific research. I urge my colleagues to support this bill, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Lipinski. And the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Moulinar, is recognized for his opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Smith, for holding this markup today and including consideration of this bill. I was pleased to join Ranking Member Lipinski in introducing the bill and thank him for his continued hard work on this legislation, which he introduced last year as well. The Office of Science and Technology Policy, in coordination with the State Department, represents the United States in bilateral and multilateral meetings with foreign nations and works closely with government science agencies and independent research and scientific institutions and non-government organizations to promote science and technology initiatives and strengthen global science cooperation. Science and technology research addresses some of the major challenges facing our nation, including energy production, public health, national security, and economic development. While many federal agencies are engaged with international partners on science and technology projects, there is a need to coordinate these projects across the federal government and to identify opportunities for additional collaboration. Interagency coordination ensures that taxpayer dollars are used efficiently and that U.S. priorities are consistently addressed when working with our international partners on science and technology issues. H.R. 1156 will improve our nation's collaborative efforts with international partners on scientific issues. Better collaboration with our partners will strengthen U.S. scientific activities and further promote the free exchange of ideas with other nations. I urge my colleagues to support this bill, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Moulinar. I am not aware of any amendments, and if not, a reporting...
Mr. Chairman.
The gentleman from California, Mr. Rohrbach, is recognized.
I will
for what purpose?
I will be supporting the amendment, but I'd like to make sure that we establish a...
The gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes.
Oh, pardon me. Excuse me. I will be supporting the amendment, but I would like to make sure that we establish a dialogue as to the purpose of this amendment so that maybe perhaps on the floor, if it comes to the House, if there is an opportunity to amend. I think that it is, I have just respect, great deal of respect for the authors of this, but I take it that their intent is not that we should be cooperating with scientists from countries that are governed by dictatorships, especially dictatorships that are hostile to the United States. Would the authors like to put that on the record, that that is not their intent? Maybe not. Okay. Let me just note that that especially means that I don't believe that we should be rushing into cooperation as we have. We have certain degrees of cooperation already scientifically with China, which is the world's worst human rights abuser, a country that participates in murdering prisoners and selling their organs, and has not permitted any opposition parties or any kind of freedom of political freedoms or personal freedoms that we hold dear in the United States. So I would think that it's very nice to think that we should just cooperate with everybody scientifically, but I don't believe that that is rational, and I would hope that is not the intent of the authors of this particular amendment. So that's what I have to say. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Warbacher. A reporting quorum being present, I move that the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology report H.R. 1156 to the House with the recommendation that the bill pass. The question is on favorably reporting H.R. 1156 to the House. All those in favor say aye. Opposed, nay. The ayes have it, and the bill is ordered reported favorably. Without objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table. H.R. 1156 is ordered reported to the House, and I ask unanimous consent that staff be authorized to make any necessary technical and conforming changes, and without objection, so ordered. We'll now go to the third bill, and pursuant to notice, I now call up H.R. 1162, the Science Prize Competitions Act, and the clerk will report the bill.
H.R. 1162, to make technical changes to provisions authorizing prize competitions under the Stevenson-Wadler Technology Innovation Act.
Without objection, the bill will be considered as read, and the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Byers, is recognized to explain the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to begin by apologizing for making Representative Comstock late. We are both Cannon dwellers, and she trusted me to find room 2318 on the first floor of Rayburn. So my apologies
fair to enough.
Representative Comstock and myself.
Fair enough.
I'm very pleased that we are marking up legislation today for H.R. 1162, the Prize Competition Act, and I really want to thank Mr. Johnson for co-sponsoring, and we're both pleased to welcome the co-sponsorship of Chairman Smith and Ranking Member Johnson and Representatives Bonamici and Perlmutter. The 2010 Competes Reauthorization grants all federal agencies broad federal prize authority, and this authority supports agencies' increased use of prizes to incentivize more high-risk, high-reward research and reach out to a new audience of researchers and innovators across all areas of science and technology. Prize competitions go back at least 300 years to the 1714 Longitude Prize offered by the British government to develop a practical method to precisely measure a ship's longitude. And I recommend, by the way, a fascinating read, Dava Sobel's book, Longitude, The True Story of a Lone Genius Who Solved the Greatest Scientific Problem of His Time. The 1919 Ortigue Prize spurred Charles Lindbergh to make the first transatlantic flight, but it took 8 years before he made that famous flight that changed history. There were many, many efforts leading up to 1927, and by the way, I recommend Bill Bryson's book, One Summer, that has an excellent chapter on the various attempts to win that prize. In more recent years, prize competitions have accelerated technological development for space exploration, public health, automobiles, lighting, big data, and much more. Many of these competitions have been privately sponsored, but several have been sponsored by our federal science agencies, including NASA, DARPA, and the Department of Energy. And Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, my children and I have had our computers set to do SETI research and the search for new prime numbers for years now, every time they're sleeping. We hope to win a prize someday. Prize competitions have also proven to be an effective tool to invigorate our nation's brightest innovators from all corners. They allow our science agencies to cast a wide net to draw in new talent. NASA, for example, found that over 80% of NASA prize competitors had never before responded to NASA or other government agencies for proposals. If we're to continue leading the world in science and technology, we must draw upon all of our nation's talent, whether they're researchers in a university lab, owners of a technology startup, or independent innovators working in their own garage. Imagine if more of our federal science agencies took full advantage of the potential of prizes to address some of our nation's most pressing technological challenges. How might the world be changed in 2025 from a prize offer today? Private organizations, by the way, have spent years perfecting the design of prize competitions to address big challenges. And again, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, let me say that the five automobile franchises our family business represents have got this perfected, which is why it is so good to buy a car the last weekend of every month, because the prizes, the cash prizes, are very significant.
Okay, and good.
We have to hope that our science agency.
We're getting lots of practical tips today. By the way, Mr. Bryan, I have to tell you, since you're the author of this bill, There's a direct conflict of interest if you win the prize, so I think you'll have to return it.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We hope that our science agencies will see the same success, and we must continue to support them. So the legislation we're considering today addresses real and perceived hurdles in the 2010 authority that were identified once the agencies began to implement prize competitions. It also aligns the terminology with the industry standard to eliminate any confusion in the interpretation of the law. These are technical amendments. This should make it easier for all agencies to make full use of the 2010 prize authority. So in trying to rebalance our federal budget, we've had to make hard choices about where to cut funding, including for R&D programs. And while prize competition shouldn't be used as an excuse to cut our investments in R&D, they do allow us to continue to fund high-reward research with minimal risk to the taxpayer. They're a valuable tool for agencies to deploy to meet their critical mission responsibilities. I'm proud to co-sponsor this bill with Mr. Johnson. I ask my colleagues for their support. I yield back the balance of our time.
Thank you, Mr. Beyer. And the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Johnson, is recognized for his statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this markup and for considering H.R. 1162, the Science Prize Competitions Act. I, too, was pleased to join the ranking member of the Oversight Subcommittee, Mr. Beyer, in introducing this bill, and I thank him for his initiative. In 2011, the President signed into law the America Competes Reauthorization Act. Last year, this committee passed the Frontiers in Innovation, Research, Science, and Technology, or FIRST Act. One look at the titles of these bills, and you can understand the importance of the theme of the Science Prize Competitions Act. Competitions help spur innovation, allowing innovators to emerge based on merit, which often produces revolutionary outside-the-box ideas. Consider the Head Health Challenge, a joint effort by the NFL, Under Armour, GE, and NIST to produce viable materials that will result in increased safety and protection for athletes, the warfighter, and civilians. This is just one example of a competition to create a solution that would impact a diverse section of the population, from athletes to soldiers. H.R. 1162 makes some important changes to the prize competition section of the Stevenson-Widler Technology Innovation Act of 1980. This legislation includes improvements for consistency and accuracy, as well as changes that better define the role of the private sector in various aspects of prize competitions. H.R. 1162 will have a positive impact on science prize competitions, and I urge my colleagues to support the bill. With that, I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. And I understand you have an amendment to the bill, and if so, you're recognized to offer that amendment.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. My amendment directs...
The gentleman has an amendment at the desk, and the clerk report the amendment.
Yeah, I do have an amendment at the desk, Mr. Chairman.
Amendment to H.R. 1162 offered by Mr. Johnson of Ohio. Page 5, line 7.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman is recognized to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My amendment directs the Office of Science and Technology Policy to include a description of cross-cutting topical areas and agency-specific mission needs that may be the strongest opportunities for prize competitions during the upcoming two fiscal years. The amendment aims to guide federal agencies to be forward-thinking and strategic about how to best utilize prizes in an optimal and an efficient way that will drive the greatest innovation while also helping to meet federal agency goals. Used effectively, prize competitions can be a tool to generate innovative results, and by inserting this reporting requirement in the OSTP report, agencies may be incentivized to be a bit more thoughtful about how they use prizes within the context of their larger research and development and mission strategies. I urge my colleagues to support my amendment as well. With that, I yield back.
Okay. Before the gentleman yields back, would he yield to me?
Mr. Chairman, I absolutely will yield.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I want to say that I am in support of this amendment, which proposes language developed with the minority to identify the best future opportunities for science prizes. This amendment is in keeping with the overarching objective of the legislation to encourage agencies to strategically utilize prize competitions. The amendment improves an already good bill, and I recommend that we accept it. Are there other members who wish to be heard on the amendment? Mr. Beyer.
I'd just like to say that I support Mr. Johnson's amendment. The changes are consistent with the underlying act, and I urge my colleagues to support it.
Thank you, Mr. Byron. Hearing No other requests for amendments. The question is on agreeing to the amendment offered by Mr. Johnson. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. And the ayes have it. The amendment is agreed to. If there are no further amendments and a reporting quorum being present, I move that the committee on the gentlewoman from Oregon, Ms. Bonamici, is recognized.
Mr. Chairman, I move to strike the last word.
The gentlewoman is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased to speak in support of H.R. 1162, a bill introduced by my colleagues, Mr. Byer and Mr. Johnson, and I applaud them for working together in a bipartisan fashion on this common sense legislation to improve the scientific enterprise. The Science Prizes Competitions Act is an important follow-up to the work this committee has taken on the America Competes Act, an important piece of legislation that I hope the committee will continue to work on and improve. The prizes authorized in the legislation sought to spur innovation in the private sector and develop cutting-edge technology to help solve our nation's public policy challenges. The proposal we're considering today makes some technical changes to the prize authority to make it easier for agencies to conduct prize competitions and continue to spur the innovation that's a central priority of this committee. And I thank my colleagues for their work on this bill and urge everyone to support this straightforward proposal and yield back the balance of my time. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bonamici. The gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Lipinski.
Chair, I move to strike last word.
The gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes.
I just want to add, Mr. Byer went through a list of successful prizes. Hopefully the H prize will be one of those in the future. I'm very happy DOE has moved forward on that. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Lipinski. Any further comments? If not, I move that the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology report H.R. 1162 to the House as amended with the recommendation that the bill pass. The question is on favorably reporting H.R. 1162 to the House as amended. All those in favor say aye. Opposed, nay. The ayes have it, and the bill is ordered reported favorably. With that objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table. H.R. 1162 is ordered reported to the House, and I ask unanimous consent that the staff be authorized to make any necessary technical and conforming changes, and with that objection, so ordered. Congratulations, Mr. Byer. You win the prize. And the ranking member, Ms. Johnson, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I failed to acknowledge that Mr. Connell, who had previously served on the committee, is back, and we're delighted to have him. He's joining the most important committee of this Congress for the future of the nation.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson, and we welcome him back, although speaking as a chairman, to have a Mr. Tonko and Takano sitting next to each other might lead to some confusion in the future. Yes, the gentleman's recognized.
Mr. Chairman, we're going to lobby to get Mr. Takai on the committee. Then you'll have the full Takakis here.
That is good. That is good. We don't have any vacancies on the committee right now, fortunately. Pursuant to notice, I now call up H.R. 1158, the Department of Energy Laboratory Modernization and Technology Transfer Act of 2015, and the clerk will report the bill.
H.R. 1158, a bill to improve management of the national laboratories, enhance technology commercialization, facilitate public-private partnerships, and for other purposes.
Without objection, the bill is considered as read and open for amendment at any point. And the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Holtgren, is recognized for his opening statement.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I ask unanimous consent to enter into the record 4 letters of support from a diverse set of organizations that signify the broad support this legislation has.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you. The 4 letters are the Clean Air Task Force, the Task Force on American Innovation, the United States Nuclear Infrastructure Council, and a broad coalition of nonprofit research institutions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would also like to thank the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Perlmutter, for helping me bring this bill to markup. H.R. 1158, the Department of Energy Modernization and Technology Transfer Act, ensures that the Department of Energy has the tools it needs to allow new startups, small businesses, universities, and the general public at large to do what they do best, react to market signals, and innovate. The federal government and the national labs fill a vital role doing the basic research needed to maintain America's role as a safe and innovative nation. Their ability to build large research tools at our user facilities is the crown jewel in our nation's research capabilities, and they are the model other nations are copying. Far too often, however, the discoveries made in our labs get stuck in the labs. This is due to a number of reasons that this bill seeks to break down some of those barriers and make this happen. By extending the pilot for the ACT agreements within DOE, the labs are given the ability to negotiate more flexible contracts with non-federal entities that would like to take the lab's research and turn it into a viable product. Section 201 of the bill also allows researchers using federal funds to enter into these agreements so long as any federal funds are used exclusively for their intended research purposes. Section 203 of the bill will begin to chip away at what many call the valley of death, the hurdle many startups never get over because they cannot prove their concept. This section would allow DOE to use their tech transfer funds for early stage pre-commercial proof of concept demonstrations so the private sector can finally pick up technologies and develop them with private funds. This legislation would also grant to the directors of national labs the signature authority for many agreements with non-federal entities. These are decisions that the Secretary of Energy must make under current law, meaning decisions a lab director can make over a phone call in the course of a day must weave their way through an unnecessary bureaucracy before it lands on the Secretary's desk. This bill also seeks to improve the department's relationship with small businesses that can take part in the SBIR STTR program, as well as encourages the Secretary to enter into agreements with the I-Corps program at NSF. While I do understand that DOE has begun a similar pilot called LabCorp, I'm worried that this pilot housed in EERE is so narrow in focus that it will not be applicable for most of our lab's advancements. An accelerator technology being developed for medical treatments, for instance, would not be able to access the current pilot. Section 104 of this legislation will also require DOE to undertake an honest assessment of its capabilities to authorize, host, and oversee prototype reactors at DOE sites. This is a critical issue for the United States' position as a nuclear technology leader. The United States has not hosted a new research reactor in decades, and there are not any current applications under review at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Unfortunately, the U.S. has become so risk-averse that we have regulated ourselves out of business for building the concept reactors that might someday lead to commercially deployable, safer, and more efficient nuclear technologies. We are driving companies overseas, so I look forward to seeing the results of this section's report language from DOE. Our national labs have been at the cutting edge of technological development, and we must always ensure that it is in the national interest. This bill helps to ensure that is the case, because a discovery lost in the lab is a discovery wasted. And that is why I encourage my colleagues to support this bill, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Hogren. And the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Perlmutter, is recognized for his statement.
For allowing me to carry this, and my friend Mr. Hultgren for sponsoring this bill. So this bill, as Mr. Hultgren was saying, basically streamlines the ability to bring ideas, inventions, innovations from the laboratory to commercial application. It extends the agreement for commercializing technology or ACT pilot program for 2 more years and also significantly broadens the range of companies able to participate in the program, allowing for more flexible partnership agreements. The bill also allows laboratories to use their technology transfer fund for activities which identify and demonstrate commercial opportunities for their particular research and technologies. And going just beyond just the labs, the bill streamlines management and coordination of DOE's full spectrum of energy activities from basic research through commercial application by establishing a single undersecretary for science and energy. It removes the burdens which currently prevent many universities and other nonprofit research institutions from working with the department, and it authorized DOE to partner with the National Science Foundation, allowing DOE researchers to participate in the National Science Foundation's groundbreaking Innovation Corps program. This is important for matching researchers with entrepreneurs to help get their ideas out of the lab and into the marketplace. Lastly, the bill includes important reporting and accountability measures enabling Congress to fully evaluate the effectiveness of these new tools and determine any additional steps we should be taking down the road. I represent Golden, Colorado, which is the home of the National Renewable Energy Lab. And the National Renewable Energy Lab, and I'll call it NREL, is by far the premier laboratory in the world for energy efficiency and renewable energy technologies. For more than 40 years, NREL has led the charge in research and design of renewable energy and energy efficient products directly impacting the way we utilize and secure American energy. I've long been an advocate for NREL and will continue to do so for many years to come. I look forward to working with this committee and my colleagues on both sides of the aisle to continue support for NREL and the other laboratories, which really we have about a dozen or 14 laboratories from the West Coast to the East. This bill will help provide the labs with new tools so they can best lead our country's research on renewable and sustainable forms of energy, as well as other groundbreaking bits of invention and ideas, and ultimately bring these life-changing innovations to consumers. One of the things that the bill does is help streamline public-private partnerships. Last year, DOE signed an agreement for commercializing technology with the Wells Fargo Foundation to utilize NREL and the other laboratories to further research in energy-efficient building-related technologies. Through this new partnership, the Wells Fargo Foundation was able to use the additional flexibility provided under the Act to enter into this partnership and advance new technologies. DOE's national laboratories and research programs have been the birthplace to some of our most revolutionary inventions and technologies. When this research is harnessed by entrepreneurs and business leaders, startups with one or two employees can grow into companies that create hundreds of quality jobs. We want to make sure these federally funded institutions and initiatives remain an important foundation of our knowledge-based economy. That's why I'm proud to co-sponsor this legislation with my friend from Illinois, Mr. Hultgren. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Perlmutter. We have a couple of amendments, and the first one I think will be offered by the gentleman from California, Mr. Swalwell, and he is recognized for that purpose.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do have an amendment at this.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment 2, H.R. 1158, offered by Mr. Swalwell of
California. And I ask, Mr. Chairman, for unanimous consent that the reading of the amendment be dispensed.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman from California is recognized to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I do appreciate this piece of legislation and the gentleman that worked on it. My amendment makes a small clarifying change, which would apply to page 13, line 15, and it would say that this section does not apply to any agreement with a majority foreign-owned company. It would still allow the Department of Energy to enter into an agreement with a foreign-owned company, but it would preclude the lab director from doing so. And so I, just like the gentleman from Colorado, I'm a big supporter of giving more authority to our lab directors. I have two national laboratories, Sandia and Lawrence Livermore Laboratory, doing great work, especially in renewables and clean energy and addressing the issues of climate change, and I believe that this amendment will give them the authority to do everything they need to strike public-private partnerships, but also address some concerns that the Department of Energy has, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Swalwell, and I'll recognize myself in support of the amendment, which would exclude any majority foreign-owned company from participation in the Section 202 public-private partnerships in the bill. I think this is a good amendment. Recommend that we accept it. Is there any further discussion on the amendment? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The ayes have it, and the amendment is agreed to. The second amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from New York, Mr. Tonko. And does the gentleman wish to be recognized?
Thank you. I do, Mr. Chair.
The gentleman is recognized to offer an amendment.
Right. Mr. Chair, I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 1158, offered by Mr. Tonko of New York. Page 13.
Without objection, the amendment will be considered as read, and the gentleman from New York is recognized to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. H.R. 1158 is an experiment. It's an experiment in increasing the flexibility available to directors of our national laboratories with the goal of accelerating the commercialization of some amazing discoveries and innovations made at these labs. Toward this end, one of the many significant provisions in the bill would allow national laboratory directors to spend up to $1 million per technology transfer agreement without the approval of the Secretary of Energy. At its best, it will speed up the process to finalize an agreement by eliminating the departmental review currently required. This is a fundamental change, allowing contractors to add work to their own contract without department approval or immediate oversight. It is indeed an experiment. If reducing the time needed to finalize an agreement increases the willingness of new private sector entities to engage with the national laboratories and it increases the ability of national laboratories to move their innovations into the commercial sector, it's an experiment worth trying. But this proposal has many potential outcomes, not just those that we'd like to see. There is potential for the funding to go to private entities that are already well engaged with the national laboratories, and so the provision may not end up resulting in new partnerships after all. There is potential for private entities to segment a project into multiple agreements to access a greater, riskier total investment. And more broadly, there is potential for private entities to use their access to the national laboratories in ways that won't benefit our economic competitiveness as a nation. This amendment provides a backstop to all the potential outcomes that aren't required or desired or wanted. It enables the Secretary to terminate an agreement within 30 days if the Department determines that it is not in the best interests of the nation, and it allows the Secretary to remove this fast-track authority if DOE finds that it is being used for activities that are not consistent with DOE's mission. I understand that the majority has some concerns with this amendment in its current form, so I would offer to withdraw it if the chair, and certainly working with Representative Hulgren and Representative Perlmutter and myself, would agree to work on the bill so that we can bring it to the floor to see if we can address these issues together. With that, I yield back, Mr. Chair.
And I'll recognize myself in response. Mr. Tonko, I just want to say I appreciate the amendment. I think that it has some good parts, and we will continue to work with you to try to see if we can't resolve some of our differences between now and the House floor.
Well, I thank you, Mr. Chair, and with that, I withdraw the amendment and yield back.
Without objection, the amendment is withdrawn. Thank you. If there are no further amendments, gentlemen from Illinois, Mr. Lipinski is recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman, I move to strike the last word.
The gentleman is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be brief. I just want to add my voice to the other members that have spoken in support of Mr. Holcren's bill. In addition to the flexibility that this bill would provide to labs like Argonne in my district, as Mr. Perlmutter said, this bill would also encourage DOE participation in National Science Foundation's I-Corps program. I'd originally placed this language in Ms. Johnson's competes reauthorization bill last year, and I'm glad to see it included here as well. The bill also includes language supporting the newly formed Office of Technology Transitions, which I have been working with DOE to create for several years now. Support for technology maturation would be a game changer for our national labs. So once again, I thank Mr. Holcren for introducing this bill, and I urge my colleagues to support it, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Lipinski. If there are no further amendments and a reporting quorum being present, I move that the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology report H.R. 1158 to the House as amended with the recommendation of the bill do pass. Question is on favorably reporting H.R. 1158 to the House as amended. All those in favor say aye. Opposed, nay. The ayes have it, and the bill is ordered reported favorably. Without objection, the motion to consider is laid upon the table. H.R. 1158 is ordered reported to the House, and I ask unanimous consent that staff be authorized to make any necessary technical and conforming changes. Without objection, so ordered. We will now take up our fifth and last bill today, and pursuant to notice, I now call up H.R. 874, the American Supercomputing Leadership Act, and the clerk will report the bill.
H.R. 874, a bill to amend the Department of Energy High-End Computing Revitalization Act of 2004 to improve the high-end computing research and development program of the Department of Energy and for other purposes.
Without objection, the bill will be considered as read, and the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Holcren, is recognized to explain the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd also like to thank my colleague from California, Mr. Swalwell, for helping me to reintroduce this bill. This legislation will help ensure America stays at the forefront of supercomputing technology by getting to the exascale level of computing, close to the speed of the human brain. These capabilities are vital for our national security, the economy, and more broadly, the research capabilities of our nation. While America and American companies are still leading the way for much of this current technology, it's important to point out that the National University of Defense Technology in China is now housing the world's fastest computer. One of the Department of Energy's primary responsibilities within the National Nuclear Security Administration is the maintenance of our current nuclear stockpile. This stockpile stewardship responsibility is carried out with increasingly complex simulations as our stockpile ages. The need for improved parallelism capabilities and decreased energy requirements are spelled out in this legislation to ensure the department carries out a targeted basic research program to overcome the most pressing needs. I'd like to point out, however, that I believe in agreement with the Secretary that exascale cannot be seen as the end point. It's just a step towards the greater goal of American leadership in this field. This legislation will ensure that the broader scientific community has access to these facilities on a competitive merit review process. The scientific drivers and the national security responsibility should be the primary focus of this research, but we must also make sure that the cross-cutting benefits of this research are not left at the wayside. This legislation would create partnerships with universities, industry, and the national labs to conduct this research, ensuring that the nation as a whole benefits from this research more quickly and efficiently. With all parties at the table, businesses will better be able to utilize the new technologies and algorithms that will come about. Having the pleasure to represent the great state of Illinois, I've been able to witness how an ecosystem of innovation can best be fostered. For a nation to reap the greatest yields from our research facilities must be open to the public when it makes sense and does not interfere with the core mission of our federal agencies and the labs. The user facilities at our national labs already serve over 30,000 researchers every year, with universities having first dibs for any available space. And user facilities, such as the Advanced Photon Source at Argonne, have given a tremendous research capability to industry partners, such as pharmaceutical companies, where research that once took weeks is now done in hours. The computing capabilities this legislation will help bring about will have tremendous application in healthcare and drug development. We are just now getting to the point where computer simulations are giving us higher resolution images at the molecular level than we can get with microscopes when trying to understand how diseases, our bodies, and new treatments react. For instance, the World Health Organization has listed erythromycin on its essential medicines list, and it has been used for over 50 years. While we know the result of taking such medication as a protein synthesis inhibitor, it was not until research was done in partnership with University of Illinois and Beckman Institute for Advanced Science and Technology to model this reaction that we were able to unlock how it worked at the molecular level. With increasing antibiotic resistance, understanding how these medicines work will be of increasing importance. And the modeling simulations these systems make available will allow manufacturers to build better prototypes that have already been tested thousands of times virtually before they come off the line. That is why I thank the chairman for bringing this bill to markup, and I recommend my colleagues vote in favor of this legislation, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Hochgren, and the gentleman from California, Mr. Swalwell, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I also want to thank my colleague from Illinois for working again with me on H.R. 874, a bipartisan legislation that I've had the pleasure of developing with Mr. Hochgren. It would authorize an exascale computer program to support the next generation of the fastest computers in the world, oftentimes which have been held at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. And for anyone not familiar with exascale, that refers to the generation of supercomputers in general and refers to computing systems that would be able to carry out 1,000,000,000,000,000,000 operations per second. That is a 1 with 18 zeros following it. That's about 50 times faster than the world's fastest computers today. Representing a district that contains two Department of Energy laboratories, Lawrence Livermore and Sandia, I know very well, just as Mr. Hochgren does, how vital developing these capabilities are to ensuring that we remain the world leader. For example, the Sequoia system at Lawrence Livermore, currently the third fastest in the world, is performing calculations that are critical to ensuring the reliability of our nuclear weapons stockpile and ensuring that we do not have to test them. This important work allows us to maintain our national security while abiding by the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. This legislation would authorize the Secretary of Energy to support research aimed at significantly increasing the computing power available to scientists from DOE, industry, universities, and other federal agencies. As I have mentioned, the capabilities made possible by these investments would enable our best and brightest scientists to gain new insights into everything from Alzheimer's to climate change. The potential benefits from advancing high-end computers to cut across sectors and include research into high-temperature superconductivity and include significant reductions in energy losses in transmitting electricity, also aerodynamic modeling for aircraft and vehicle design, pharmaceutical redevelopment, fusion plasma modeling, and combustion simulation to guide the design of fuel-efficient clean engines, which is currently being explored at Sandia National Laboratory's Combustion Research Facility. Finally, this legislation would also require that the Department of Energy submit a management plan, as well as regular reports to Congress detailing how the Department of Energy expects to implement this program, as well as its progress to date. With this bipartisan legislation, we will establish a transparent program that will allow the United States to continue to be a leader in high-end computing. I expect that we may well reap benefits from this program, even beyond what Mr. Holmgren and I have spoken about today, and further advances are here to come. I urge my colleagues to join Mr. Holmgren and I in H.R. 874, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Swalwell. Is there any further discussion? The gentlewoman from Oregon, Ms. Bonamici. I was looking at you expecting that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to strike the last word.
The gentlewoman is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The American Supercomputing Leadership Act is an important bill and one that I'm glad to support as a co-sponsor. This bipartisan legislation promotes the development of the next generation of the fastest computers in the world right here in the United States and supports the development of computing capabilities that are vital to maintaining our leadership in a wide range of research areas. I'm honored to represent a district that has more than 1,700 Intel employees and an economy that's very dependent on technology and innovation. So I especially appreciate this legislation. This bill will support research to significantly increase the computing power available to scientists from DOE, industry, universities, and other federal agencies, and these investments will enable our best and brightest scientists to gain new insights in an array of societal concerns, from Alzheimer's disease to climate change. I'd like to take a moment to express my appreciation to the sponsors of this legislation, Mr. Holmgren and Mr. Swalwell, and thank them for their efforts to craft this bipartisan bill we have before us today. I strongly urge all of my colleagues to support this legislation, and I yield back the balance of my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Bonamici. If there are no amendments and no further discussion, a reporting quorum being present, I move that the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology report H.R. 874 to the House with the recommendation that the bill do pass. The question is on favorably reporting H.R. 874 to the House. All those in favor say aye. Opposed, nay. The ayes have it, and the bill is ordered reported favorably. With that objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table. H.R. 874 is ordered reported to the House, and I ask unanimous consent that the staff be authorized to make any necessary technical and conforming changes, and with that objection, so ordered. Before we officially adjourn, I just want to congratulate the members who had a hand in developing these bills today. It was a nice cross-section of the committee, and it's pretty unusual for new members to get bills, so congratulations to them as well. If there's no further discussion, that completes our business and concludes the full committee markup. With that objection, the committee stands adjourned.
We vote for more, I think.
We vote for more, I think. Yeah.